Recorded Books presents The Social Conquest of Earth by Edward O. Wilson, narrated by Jonathan Hogan and directed by Stephen Bartolome.
Prologue. There is no grail more elusive or precious in the life of the mind than the key to understanding the human condition. It has always been the custom of those who seek it to explore the labyrinth of myth. For religion, the myths of creation and the dreams of prophets. For philosophers, the insights of introspection and reasoning based upon them. For the creative arts, statements based upon a play of the senses. Great visual art, in particular, is the expression of a person's journey, an evocation of feeling that cannot be put into words. Perhaps in the hitherto hidden lies deeper, more essential meaning. Paul Gauguin, hunter of secrets and famed maker of myths, as he has been called, made this attempt. His story is a worthy backdrop for the modern answer to be offered in the present work. Late in 1897, at Punauia, 3 miles from the Tahitian port of Papeete, Gauguin sat down to put on canvas his largest and most important painting. He was weak from syphilis and a series of debilitating heart attacks. His funds were nearly gone, and he was depressed by the news that his daughter Aline had recently died of pneumonia in France. Gauguin knew his time was running out. He meant this painting to be his last. And so, when he finished, he went into the mountains behind Papeete to commit suicide. He carried with him a vial of arsenic he had stored, perhaps unaware of how painful death by this poison can be. He intended to hide himself before he took it, so that his corpse would not be found right away, and instead would be eaten by ants. But then he relented and returned to Punauia. Although there was very little left to his life, he had decided to soldier on. To survive, he took a 6-franc-a-day job in Papeete as a clerk in the Office of Public Works and Surveys. In 1901, he sought even greater isolation, moving to the little island of Hiva'oa in the faraway Marquesas archipelago. 2 years later, while embroiled in legal problems, Paul Gauguin died of syphilitic heart failure. He was buried in the Catholic cemetery on Hiva'oa. "I am a savage," he wrote a magistrate a few days before the end, "and civilized people suspect this, for in my works there is nothing so surprising and baffling as this savage in spite of myself aspect." Gauguin had come to French Polynesia, to this almost impossible end of the world, only Pitcairn and Easter Island are more remote, to find both peace and a new frontier of artistic expression. He attained the second, if not the first. Gauguin's journey of body and mind was unique among major artists of his era. Born in Paris in 1848, he was raised in Lima and then Orléans by his half-Peruvian mother. This ethnic mix gave a hint of what was to come. As a young man, he joined the French merchant marines and traveled around the world for 6 years. During this period, in 1870 to 1871, he saw action in the Franco-Prussian War, in the Mediterranean and North Sea. Back in Paris, he at first gave little thought to art, instead becoming a stockbroker under the guidance of his wealthy guardian, Gustave Arosa. His interest in art was sparked and sustained by Arosa, a major collector of French art, including the latest works of Impressionism. When the French stock market crashed in January 1882, and his own bank failed, Gauguin turned to painting and began to develop his considerable talent. Nurtured in Impressionism by painters of undoubted greatness, Pissarro, Cézanne, Van Gogh, Manet, Seurat, Degas, he strove to join their ranks. As he traveled about from Pontoise to Rouen, from Pont-Aven to Paris, he created portraits, still lifes, landscapes, in work increasingly phantasmagoric, portending the Gauguin who was to emerge. But Gauguin was disappointed with the result and lingered only a short time in the company of his dazzling contemporaries. He had not grown rich and famous with his own efforts, even though, as he later declared, he knew he was a great artist. He longed for a simpler, easier life to meet this destiny. Paris, he wrote in 1886, is a wasteland for a poor man. I am going to Panama to live the life of a native. I shall take my paints and brushes and reinvigorate myself far from the company of men. It was not just poverty that drove Gauguin from civilization. He was at heart a restless soul, an adventurer, ever anxious to find what lay beyond the place he lived. In art, he was accordingly an experimentalist. In his wanderings, he was drawn to the exoticism of non-Western cultures and wanted to immerse himself in them in search of new modes of visual expression. He spent time in Panama and then Martinique. Returning home, he applied for a position in the French-ruled province of Tonkin, now northern Vietnam. When that failed, he turned at last to French Polynesia, the ultimate paradise. On June 9, 1891, Gauguin arrived at Papeete and immersed himself in the indigenous culture. In time, he became an advocate of native rights and therefore a troublemaker in the eyes of the colonial authorities. Of vastly greater importance, he pioneered the new style called primitivism, flat, pastoral, often violently colorful, simple and direct, and authentic. We cannot escape the conclusion, however, that Gauguin sought more than just this new style. He was also deeply interested in the human condition, in what it truly is, and how to portray it. The venues of metropolitan France, especially Paris, were a domain of a thousand voices shouting for attention, where intellectual and artistic life was ruled by recognized authorities, each rooted in his own small acreage of expertise. No one, he felt, could make a new unity out of that cacophony. Such might be done, however, in the vastly simpler, yet still wholly functional world of Tahiti. There one might possibly cut down to the bedrock of the human condition. In this respect, Gauguin was one with Henry David Thoreau, who earlier had retreated to his tiny cabin on the edge of Walden Pond to front only the essential facts of life and see if I could not learn what it had to teach, to cut a broad swath and shave close, to drive life into a corner and reduce it to its lowest terms. That perception is best expressed by Gauguin on his 12-foot-wide masterwork. Look closely at its details. It contains a row of figures arrayed in front of a faint mélange of Tahitian landscapes, mountain, and sea. Most of the figures are female, this being the Tahitian Gauguin. Variously realistic and surreal, they represent the human life cycle. The artist intends for us to scan from right to left. A baby at the far right represents birth. An adult of ambiguous sex has been placed in the center, arms raised, a symbol of individual self-recognition. Nearby, to the left, a young couple picking and eating apples are the Adam and Eve archetype, in quest of knowledge. On the far left, representing death, an old woman is hunched in anguish and despair. Thought to have been inspired by Albrecht Dürer's 1514 engraving, Melancholia. A blue-tinted idol stares at us from the left background, arms lifted ritualistically, perhaps benign or perhaps malignant. Gauguin himself described its meaning with telling poetic ambiguity. The idol is there not as a literary explanation, but as a statue, less statue perhaps than the animal figures, less animal too, becoming one in my dream, in front of my hut, with the whole of nature, dominating our primitive soul, the imaginary consolation of our sufferings, and what they contain of the value and the uncomprehending before the mystery of our origins and our future. On the upper left corner of the canvas, he wrote the famous title, D'où venons-nous? Que sommes-nous? Où allons-nous? The painting is not an answer. It is a question. Part 1. Why does advanced social life exist? Chapter 1. The Human Condition. Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Conceived in ultimate simplicity by Paul Gauguin on the canvas of his Tahitian masterpiece, these are in fact the central problems of religion and philosophy. Will we ever be able to solve them? Sometimes it seems not. Yet, perhaps we can. Humanity today is like a waking dreamer, caught between the fantasies of sleep and the chaos of the real world. The mind seeks but cannot find the precise place and hour. We have created a Star Wars civilization with Stone Age emotions, medieval institutions, and godlike technology. We thrash about. We are terribly confused by the mere fact of our existence and a danger to ourselves and to the rest of life. Religion will never solve this great riddle. Since Paleolithic times, each tribe, of which there have been countless thousands, invented its own creation myth. During this long dream time of our ancestors, supernatural beings spoke to shamans and prophets. They identified themselves to the mortals variously as God, a tribe of gods, a divine family, the Great Spirit, the Sun, ghosts of the forebears, supreme serpents, hybrids of sundry animals, chimeras of men and beasts, omnipotent sky spiders, anything, everything that could be conjured by the dreams, hallucinogens, and fertile imaginations of the spiritual leaders. They were shaped, in part, by the environments of those who invented them. In Polynesia, gods pried the sky apart from the ground and sea, and the creation of life and humanity followed. In the desert-dwelling patriarchies of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, prophets conceived, not surprisingly, a divine, all-powerful patriarch who speaks to his people through sacred scripture. The creation stories gave the members of each tribe an explanation for their existence. It made them feel loved and protected above all other tribes. In return, their gods demanded absolute belief and obedience. And rightly so. The creation myth was the essential bond that held the tribe together. It provided its believers with a unique identity, commanded their fidelity, strengthened order, vouchsafed law, encouraged valor and sacrifice, and offered meaning to the cycles of life and death. No tribe could long survive without the meaning of its existence defined by a creation story. The option was to weaken, dissolve, and die. In the early history of each tribe, the myth, therefore, had to be set in stone. The creation myth is a Darwinian device for survival. Tribal conflict, where believers on the inside were pitted against infidels on the outside, was a principal driving force that shaped biological human nature. The truth of each myth lived in the heart, not in the rational mind. By itself, myth-making could never discover the origin and meaning of humanity, but the reverse order is possible. The discovery of the origin and meaning of humanity might explain the origin and meaning of myths, hence the core of organized religion. Can these two worldviews ever be reconciled? The answer, to put the matter honestly and simply, is no. They cannot be reconciled. Their opposition defines the difference between science and religion, between trust in empiricism and belief in the supernatural. If the great riddle of the human condition cannot be solved by recourse to the mythic foundations of religion, neither will it be solved by introspection. Unaided rational inquiry has no way to conceive its own process. Most of the activities of the brain are not even perceived by the conscious mind. The brain is a citadel, as Darwin once put it, that cannot be taken by direct assault. Thinking about thinking is the core process of the creative arts, but it tells us very little about how we think the way we do, and nothing of why the creative arts originated in the first place. Consciousness, having evolved over millions of years of life and death struggle, and moreover, because of that struggle, was not designed for self-examination. It was designed for survival and reproduction. Conscious thought is driven by emotion. To the purpose of survival and reproduction, it is ultimately and wholly committed. The intricate distortions of the mind may be transmitted by the creative arts in fine detail, but they are constructed as though human nature never had an evolutionary history. Their powerful metaphors have brought us no closer to solving the riddle than did the dramas and literature of ancient Greece. Scientists, scouting the perimeters of the citadel, search for potential breaches in its walls. Having broken through with technology designed for that purpose, they now read the codes and track the pathways of billions of nerve cells. Within a generation, we likely will have progressed enough to explain the physical basis of consciousness. But when the nature of consciousness is solved, will we then know what we are and where we came from? No, we will not. To understand the physical operations of the brain to their foundations brings us close to the grail. To find it, however, we need far more knowledge collected from both science and the humanities. We need to understand how the brain evolved the way it did and why. Moreover, we look in vain to philosophy for the answer to the great riddle. Despite its noble purpose and history, pure philosophy long ago abandoned the foundational questions about human existence. The query itself is a reputation killer. It has become a gorgon for philosophers, upon whose visage even the best thinkers fear to gaze. They have good reason for their aversion. Most of the history of philosophy consists of failed models of the mind. The field of discourse is strewn with a wreckage of theories of consciousness. After the decline of logical positivism in the middle of the 20th century, and the attempt of this movement to blend science and logic into a closed system, professional philosophers dispersed in an intellectual diaspora. They emigrated into the more tractable disciplines not yet colonized by science: intellectual history, semantics, logic, foundational mathematics, ethics, theology, and, most lucratively, problems of personal life adjustment. Philosophers flourish in these various endeavors, but for the time being, at least, and by a process of elimination, the solution of the riddle has been left to science. What science promises, and has already supplied in part, is the following. There is a real creation story of humanity, and one only, and it is not a myth. It is being worked out and tested and enriched and strengthened step by step. I will propose that scientific advances, especially those made during the last two decades, are now sufficient for us to address in a coherent manner the questions of where we came from and what we are. To do so, however, we need answers to two even more fundamental questions the query has raised. The first is why advanced social life exists at all and has occurred so rarely in the history of life. The second is the identity of the driving forces that brought it into existence. These problems can be solved by bringing together information from multiple disciplines, ranging from molecular genetics, neuroscience, and evolutionary biology, to archaeology, ecology, social psychology, and history. To test any such theory of complex process, it is useful to bring into the light those other social conquerors of Earth, the highly social ants, bees, wasps, and termites, and I will do so. They are needed for perspective and developing the theory of social evolution. I realize I can be easily misinterpreted by putting insects next to people. Apes are bad enough, you might say, but insects? In human biology, it is always profitable to make such juxtapositions. There are precedents to comparing the lesser with the greater. Biologists have turned with great success to the bacteria and yeasts to learn the principles of human molecular genetics. They have depended on roundworms and mollusks to learn the basis of our own neural organization and memory. And fruit flies have taught us a great deal about the development of human embryos. We have no less to learn from the social insects, in this case, to add background to the origin and meaning of humanity. Part 2. Where do we come from? Chapter 2. The Two Paths to Conquest. Human beings create cultures by means of malleable languages. We invent symbols that are intended to be understood among ourselves, and we thereby generate networks of communication many orders of magnitude greater than that of any animal. We have conquered the biosphere and laid waste to it like no other species in the history of life. We are unique in what we have wrought. But we are not unique in our emotions. There are to be found, as in our anatomy and facial expressions, what Darwin called the indelible stamp of our animal ancestry. We are an evolutionary chimera, living on intelligence steered by the demands of animal instinct. This is the reason we are mindlessly dismantling the biosphere, and with it, our own prospects for permanent existence. Humanity is a magnificent but fragile achievement. Our species is still more impressive because we are the culmination of an evolutionary epoch that was continuously played out in great peril. Most of the time, our ancestral populations were very small, of a size that, in the course of mammalian history, typically carried a probability of early extinction. All the prehuman bands taken together made up a population of, at most, a few tens of thousands of individuals. Very early, the prehuman ancestors split into two or more at a time. During this period, the average life of a mammalian species was only 500,000 years. In conformity to that principle, most of the prehuman collateral lines vanished. The one destined to give rise to modern humanity veered close to extinction itself at least once, and possibly many times over the past 500,000 years. The epoch might easily have ended at any such constriction, gone forever in a geological eye blink. It could have happened during a severe drought at the wrong time and place, or an alien disease sweeping into the population from surrounding animals, or pressure from other, more competitive primates. There would then have followed nothing. The evolution of the biosphere would have pulled back, never again to produce what we became. The social insects, which currently rule the invertebrate land environment, mostly evolved into existence well over 100 million years ago. Estimates made by specialists are mid-Triassic, or 220 million years ago for the termites, late Jurassic to early Cretaceous, about 150 million years ago for the ants, and for the bumblebees and honeybees, late Cretaceous, approximately 70 to 80 million years ago. Thereafter, and for the remainder of the Mesozoic era, the diversity of the species in these several evolving lines increased in concert with the rise and spread of the flowering plants. Still, ants and termites acquired their present spectacular dominance among the land-dwelling invertebrates only after they had been around for a long period of time. Their full power was achieved gradually, one innovation at a time, reaching its current levels between 65 and 50 million years ago. As the swarms of ants and termites spread around the world, many other terrestrial invertebrates co-evolved with them, and as a result, not only survived, but prospered. Plants and animals evolved defenses against their depredations. Many became specialized to rely on ants, termites, and bees as food. These predators even included pitcher plants, sundews, and other plants able to trap and digest large numbers to add to the nutrients obtained from the soil. A vast array of plant and animal species formed intimate symbioses with the social insects, accepting them as partners. A large percentage came to depend on them entirely for survival, variously as prey, symbionts, scavengers, pollinators, or turners of the soil. Overall, the pace of evolution of ants and termites was slow enough to be balanced by counter-evolution in the rest of life. As a result, these insects were not able to tear down the rest of the terrestrial biosphere by force of numbers, but became vital elements of it. The ecosystems they dominate today are not only sustainable, but dependent on them. In sharp contrast, human beings of the single species Homo sapiens emerged in the last several hundred thousand years and spread around the world only during the last 60,000 years. There was not time for us to co-evolve with the rest of the biosphere. Other species were not prepared for the onslaught. This shortfall soon had dire consequences for the rest of life. At first, there was an environmentally benign process of species formation in the populations of our immediate ancestors scattered throughout the Old World. Most led to extinction, and hence phylogenetic dead ends, twigs on the tree of life that stopped growing. A zoologist will tell you that there was nothing unusual in this geographical pattern. In the Lesser Sunda archipelago east of Java lived the strange miniature hobbits, Homo floresiensis. They had brains not much larger than those of chimpanzees, yet developed stone tools. Of their lives, we otherwise know very little. In Europe and the Levant were to be found the Neanderthals, Homo neanderthalensis, a sister species of our own Homo sapiens. Omnivores, like our own ancestors, the Neanderthals had massive bone structures and brains even larger than those of modern Homo sapiens. They used crude but nevertheless specialized stone tools. Most of their populations adapted to the harsh climates of the Mammoth Steppe, the cold grasslands fringing the continental glacier. They might in time have evolved into an advanced human form of their own, but declined to extinction without further advance. Finally, completing the human bestiary in northern Asia, and known only from a few bone fragments as I write, was another species, the Denisovans, evidentially vicariant to the Neanderthals occupying land to the east. None of these species of Homo, and let us be generous and call them the other human species, has survived to the present day. Had any done so, it is mind-boggling to think of the moral and religious issues they would have created in modern times. Civil rights for the Neanderthals, special education for the hobbits, salvation and heaven for all? Although direct evidence is lacking, there can be little doubt about the cause of the extinction of the Neanderthals, which, judging from remains at Gibraltar, was no later than 30,000 years ago. By one means or another, through competition for food and space, or outright slaughter, or both, our ancestors were the future exterminators of this and any other species that arose during the adaptive radiation of Homo. Isolated in Africa, while the Neanderthals still lived, were archaic strains of Homo sapiens, its descendants destined to expand explosively out of the continent. They populated the Old World all the way to Australia and finally pressed beyond to the New World and distant archipelagos of Oceania. In the process, all other human species encountered were swamped and erased. Only 10,000 years ago came the invention of agriculture, occurring at least 8 times independently in the combined Old and New Worlds. Its adoption dramatically increased the food supply and, with it, the density of people on the land. This decisive advance unleashed exponential population growth and the conversion of most of the natural land environment into drastically simplified ecosystems. Wherever humans saturated wildlands, biodiversity was returned to the paucity of its earliest period 500 million years previously. The rest of the living world could not co-evolve fast enough to accommodate the onslaught of a spectacular conqueror that seemed to come from nowhere, and it began to crumble from the pressure. Even by strictly technical definition, as applied to animals, Homo sapiens is what biologists call eusocial, meaning group members containing multiple generations and prone to perform altruistic acts as part of their division of labor. In this respect, they are technically comparable to ants, termites, and other eusocial insects. But let me add immediately, there are major differences between humans and the insects, even aside from our unique possession of culture, language, and high intelligence. The most fundamental among them is that all normal members of human societies are capable of reproducing and that most compete with one another to do so. Also, human groups are formed of highly flexible alliances, not just among family members, but between families, genders, classes, and tribes. The bonding is based on cooperation among individuals or groups who know one another and are capable of distributing ownership and status on a personal basis. The necessity for fine-graded evaluation by alliance members meant that the pre-human ancestors had to achieve eusociality in a radically different way from the instinct-driven insects. The pathway to eusociality was charted by a contest between selection based on the relative success of individuals within groups versus relative success among groups. The strategies of this game were written as a complicated mix of closely calibrated altruism, cooperation, competition, domination, reciprocity, defection, and deceit. To play the game the human way, it was necessary for the evolving populations to acquire an even higher degree of intelligence. They had to feel empathy for others, to measure the emotions of friend and enemy alike, to judge the intentions of all of them, and to plan a strategy for personal social interactions. As a result, the human brain became simultaneously highly intelligent and intensely social. It had to build mental scenarios of personal relationships rapidly, both short-term and long-term. Its memories had to travel far into the past to summon old scenarios and far into the future to imagine the consequences of every relationship. Ruling on the alternative plans of action were the amygdala and other emotion-controlling centers of the brain and autonomic nervous system. Thus was born the human condition, selfish at one time, selfless at another. The two impulses often conflicted. How did Homo sapiens reach this unique place in its journey through the great maze of evolution? The answer is that our destiny was foreordained by 2 biological properties of our distant ancestors: large size and limited mobility. Back in the Mesozoic era, the first mammals were tiny compared with the largest dinosaurs around them. But they were then, as they remain to this day, mammoth in comparison with insects and other mostly invertebrate animals. After the passing of the dinosaurs, and as the age of reptiles gave way to the age of mammals, the mammals proliferated into thousands of species and filled a wide array of niches, from bats in airborne pursuit of flying insects to gigantic plankton-feeding whales plying blue water from pole to pole. The smallest bat is the size of a bumblebee, and the blue whale, growing to 80 feet in length and weighing up to 120 tons, is the largest animal of any kind that has ever lived. During the adaptive radiation of the mammalian species on the land, a few came to exceed 10 kilograms in weight, including deer and other plant-eating animals, along with big cats and other carnivores that preyed on them. It is likely that the number of species worldwide at any given time was between 5 and 10,000. Among them appeared the Old World primates, and then, in the late Eocene period, roughly 35 million years ago, the earliest Catarrhinae, including species that were to give birth to the present-day Old World monkeys, apes, and humans. Approximately 30 million years ago, the ancestors of the Old World monkeys diverged in evolution from those of modern apes and humans. Some of the proliferating species of the latter specialized on the consumption of plants, others on meat obtained by hunting or scavenging. A few fed on a mix of the two. From one of the branches of mammalian radiation arose the early prehuman line. For more reasons than size alone, the prehumans were a radically new kind of candidate for eusociality. Insects from their origin in the first vegetation on land during the early Devonian, 400 million years ago to the present day, have been encased in a knight's armor of chitinous exoskeleton. At the end of each interval of growth, they must create new, more expansive armor and shed the old above it. Whereas the muscles of mammals and other vertebrates are on the outside of the bones and pull on their outer surface, the muscles of insects are encased by their chitinous skeleton and must pull from the inside. For these reasons, insects cannot grow to the size of mammals. The largest among them in the world are African Goliath beetles, which are the size of a human fist, and waiters, cricket-like insects of almost equal size that evolved to take the ecological role in New Zealand of mice in the absence of native species on this remote archipelago. It follows that while eusocial species can dominate the insect world in terms of numbers of individuals, they had to rely on small brains and pure instinct for their conquest. Furthermore, and fundamentally, they were too small to ignite and control fire. They never, no matter how many eons should pass, could have achieved eusociality the human way. Working their way along the twisting road to eusociality, insects nevertheless had an advantage. They had wings and could travel across the land much farther than mammals. The difference becomes obvious when adjusted to scale. A human band setting out to start a new colony can comfortably travel 10 kilometers in a day to emigrate from one campsite to another. A newly inseminated fire ant queen, to take a typical example from among the thousands of species of ants, can fly about the same distance in a few hours to begin a new colony. Upon landing, she breaks off her wings, which are composed of dead tissue, like human hair and fingernails. Then she digs a small nest in the soil, and inside raises a brood of daughter workers from fat and muscle reserves in her own body. A human being is about 200 times longer than a fire ant queen, so a 10-kilometer flight for an ant is the equivalent of a walk from Boston to Washington, D.C. for a human. Even a half-minute flight of 100 meters made by a winged ant from her nest of birth to a nest site of her own is the equivalent of a half marathon for an earthbound human. The magnitude of an insect flight results in a far greater scattering of individual queen ants each generation relative to size. The same would have been true for the solitary wasp ancestors of ants, as well as the solitary protoblastoid ancestors of termites. The difference between the flying ant ancestors, with each progenitor of the next generation departing on her own, and the plodding mammalian ancestors of humans, which were forced to stay close to others, might seem at first to make the origin of advanced social behavior less likely to evolve in insects. But the opposite is true. In a constantly changing environment, the flying ant is more likely than the wandering mammal to find unoccupied space when she lands. Further, the territory she needs to survive is much smaller than that of a mammal, and is less likely to overlap with already established territories of individuals of the same species. The potential social insect has another edge. The female colonist needs no male on her journey. Once she has been inseminated during her mating flight, she carries the sperm she receives in a little storage bag, the spermatheca, inside her abdomen. She can pay out one sperm at a time to fertilize her eggs, creating hundreds or thousands of workers over a period of years. Leafcutter ants hold the record. One queen can give birth to 150 million daughter workers during her lifespan of about a dozen years. 3 to 5 million of these minions are alive at any given time, a size falling between the human populations of Latvia and Norway. Mammals, especially carnivores, have much larger territories to defend when they settle down to build a nest. Wherever they travel, they are likely to encounter rivals. Females cannot store sperm in their bodies. They must find a male and mate for each parturition. Should the opportunities and pressures of the environment make social grouping profitable, it must be done with personal bonds and alliances based on intelligence and memory. To summarize to this point on the two social conquerors of Earth, the physiology and life cycle in the ancestors of the social insects and those of humans differed fundamentally in the evolutionary pathways followed to the formation of advanced societies. The insect queen could produce robotic offspring guided by instinct. The prehumans had to rely on bonding and cooperation among individuals. The insects could evolve to use sociality by individual selection in the queen line, generation to generation. The prehumans evolved to use sociality by the interplay of selection at the level of individual selection and at the level of the group. Chapter 3. The Approach. No individual path of evolution of any kind can be predicted, either at the beginning or even toward the end of its trajectory. Natural selection can bring a species to the brink of a major revolutionary change only to turn it away. However, some trajectories of evolution can be judged as either possible or impossible, at least on this planet. Insects can evolve to be almost microscopic, but never as big as elephants. Pigs could become aquatic, but their descendants will never fly. The possible evolution of a species can be visualized as a journey through a maze. As a major advance, such as the origin of eusociality, is approached, each genetic change, each turn in the maze, either makes the attainment of that level less likely or even impossible, or else keeps it open for access to the next turn. In the earliest steps that keep other options alive, there is still a long way to go, and the ultimate, far-distant attainment is least probable. In the last few steps, there is only a short distance to go, and the attainment becomes more probable. The maze itself is subject to evolution along the way. Old corridors, ecological niches, may close, while new ones may open. The structure of the maze depends in part on who is traveling through it, including each of the species. In every game of evolutionary chance, played from one generation to the next, a very large number of individuals must live and die. The number, however, is not countless. A rough estimate can be made of it, providing at least a plausible order of magnitude guess. For the entire course of evolution, leading from our primitive mammalian forebears of 100 million years ago to the single lineage that threaded its way to become the first Homo sapiens, the total number of individuals it required might have been 100 billion. Unknowingly, they all lived and died for us. Many of the players, among the other evolving species, each containing on average a few thousand breeding individuals per generation, also frequently declined and disappeared. Had this happened to any one of the long line of ancestors leading to Homo sapiens, the human epoch would have promptly ended. Our prehuman ancestors were not chosen, nor were they great. They were just lucky. Recent research in several disciplines of science is coming together to illuminate the evolutionary steps leading to the human condition, offering at least a partial solution to the human uniqueness problem that has so bedeviled science and philosophy. Viewed through time, from the beginning to the attainment of the human condition, each step can be interpreted as a pre-adaptation. In putting it that way, I do not mean to imply that the species leading to our own were in any manner guided to such an end. Rather, each step was an adaptation in its own right, the response of natural selection to conditions prevailing around the species at that place and time. The first pre-adaptation was the aforementioned large size and relative immobility that predetermined the trajectory of mammalian evolution, as distinct from that of the social insects. The second pre-adaptation in the human-bound timeline was the specialization of the early primates 70 to 80 million years ago to life in the trees. The most important feature evolved in this change was hands and feet built for grasping. Moreover, their shape and muscles were better suited for swinging from branches rather than merely grasping them for support. Their efficiency was increased by the simultaneous appearance of opposable thumbs and great toes. It was increased further by modification of the finger and toe tips into flat nails as opposed to sharp, down-curving claws of the kind possessed by most other kinds of arboreal mammals. In addition, the palms and soles were covered by cutaneous ridges that aided in grasping, and they were supplied with pressure receptors that enhanced the sense of touch. Thus equipped, the early primate could use its hand to pick and tease apart pieces of fruit while pulling out individual seeds. The fingernail edges could both cut and scrape objects grasped by the hands. Such an animal, using its hind legs for locomotion, would be able to carry food for considerable distances. It need not use its jaws for that purpose in the manner of a cat or dog, nor was it required to regurgitate the food to its young like a nesting bird. Perhaps as an accommodation to the relatively complex manner and flexibility of their feeding behavior, and to the three-dimensional and open vegetation of their habitat, the early prehuman primates evolved a larger brain. For the same reason, they came to depend more on vision and less on smell than did most other mammals. They acquired large eyes with color vision, which were placed forward on the head to give binocular vision and a better sense of depth. When walking, the prehuman primate did not move its hind legs well apart in parallel. Instead, it alternated its legs almost in a single line, one foot placed in front of the other. The offspring, moreover, were fewer in number and required more time to develop. When one line of these strange arboreal creatures evolved to live on the ground, as it happened in Africa, the next pre-adaptation was taken, one more fortunate turn in the evolutionary maze. Bipedalism was adopted, freeing the hands for other purposes. The two living species of chimpanzees, the common chimpanzee and bonobo, man's closest phylogenetic relatives, also proceeded far in this direction and at about the same time. On the ground today, they frequently raise their arms and run or walk on their hind legs. They can even make primitive tools. Following their divergence in evolution from the chimp line, the prehumans, now distinguishable as a group of species called the Australopithecines, took the trend to bipedal walking much farther. Their body, as a whole, was accordingly refashioned. The legs were lengthened and straightened, and the feet were elongated to create a rocking movement during locomotion. The pelvis was reformed into a shallow bowl to support the viscera, which now pressed toward the legs instead of being slung ape-like beneath the horizontal body. The bipedal revolution was very likely responsible for the overall success of the Australopithecine prehumans, at least as measured by the diversity they achieved in body form, jaw musculature, and dentition. During one period, around 2 million years ago, at least 3 Australopithecine species lived on the African continent. In their body proportions, erect posture, wobbly head perched on top, and elongated hind limbs on which to run and hop, they would have looked at a considerable distance like modern humans. They almost certainly traveled in small groups in the manner of present-day hunter-gatherers. Their brain was no larger than that of a chimpanzee, yet it was from this assemblage that the ancestral species of the earliest Homo was eventually to emerge. In evolution, from diversity comes opportunity, the Australopiths found. The ancestral Australopiths and their descendant species forming the genus Homo lived in an environment conducive to straight-up walking. They never used knuckle walking, as practiced by the chimpanzees and other modern apes, with hands curved into fists and employed as forefeet. Walking with arms swinging at the side in the new Australopith manner conferred speed at minimal energy cost, even as it inflicted back and knee problems in addition to the greater risk imposed by balancing the newly heavy globular head on a delicate vertical neck. For primates whose bodies had been originally crafted for life in the trees, the bipeds could run swiftly, but they could not match the four-legged animals they hunted as prey. Antelopes, zebras, ostriches, and other animals were able to outrun them with ease over short distances. Millions of years of pursuit by lions and other carnivore sprinters had turned prey species into 100-meter champions. If the early humans, however, could not outsprint such animal Olympians, they could at least outlast them in a marathon. At some point, humans became long-distance runners. They needed only to commence a chase and track the prey for mile after mile until it was exhausted and could be overtaken. The prehuman body, thrusting itself off the ball of the foot with each step and holding a steady pace, evolved a high aerobic capacity. In time, the body also shed all of its hair, except on the head and pubis, and in the pheromone-producing armpits. It added sweat glands everywhere, allowing increased rapid cooling of the naked body surface. In Racing the Antelope, Bernd Heinrich, a distinguished biologist and record-breaking ultra-distance runner, has developed the marathon theme at length. He quotes Sean Found, the 2000 American national champion at 25 kilometers, to express the primal joy of persistence running. When you experience the run, you relive the hunt. Running is about 30 miles of chasing prey that can outrun you in a sprint and tracking it down and bringing life back to your village. It's a beautiful thing. Meanwhile, the forelimbs of the prehuman ancestors were redesigned for flexibility in the manipulation of objects. The arm, especially that of males, became efficient at throwing objects, including stones and later spears as well. And so for the first time, the prehumans could kill at a distance. The advantage this ability gave them during conflict with other, less well-equipped groups must have been enormous. At least one population of present-day common chimpanzees has developed the ability to throw stones. The behavior appears to be a cultural innovation, perhaps hit upon by a single individual. But it is inconceivable that any chimpanzee could ever match a modern human athlete. None can fling a rock at 90 miles an hour, or a spear for nearly the length of a football field. Nor could a juvenile chimp, even if trained, throw an object with the skill of a human child. Early humans had the innate equipment, and likely the tendency also, to use projectiles in capturing prey and repelling enemies. The advantages gained were surely decisive. Spear points and arrowheads are among the earliest artifacts found in archaeological sites. The environment in which the pre-human epoch unfolded was ideal for the production of the first bipeds and their marathoner descendants. During the period of critical evolution, most of sub-Saharan Africa was in a dry epoch, during which the rainforests retreated toward the equatorial belt while shrinking into scattered strongholds in the north. A large part of the continent was covered by savanna woodland, alternating with dry forest and grassland. When foraging in open areas, prehumans and Homo could stand and peer over low vegetation to watch for prey and predators intending to make them prey. When threatened, they could run to the shelters of nearby trees. Acacias and other dominant trees were relatively short, and their canopies consisted of branches spread low to the ground and easy to climb, all to the advantage of bipeds. The structure of the environment was similar to that still preserved at Serengeti, Amboseli, Gorongosa, and the other great parks of East Africa. Poets and tourists alike loved the feel of this land far more than they do other habitats of sub-Saharan Africa. They are likely moved, as I will explain later, by an instinct evolved over millions of years by their ancestors in the very same places. The cradle of humanity was not the deep rainforests with their towering canopies and dark interiors, nor was it the relatively featureless grasslands and deserts. Rather, humanity was born in the savanna forest, favored by its complex mosaic of different local habitats. The next step taken on the road to eusociality was the control of fire. Ground fires spreading from lightning strikes are a commonplace in African grasslands and forests today. When they are suppressed, as by the moist soil and forest patches around streams and in easily flooded swales, the woodland undergrowth thickens until it becomes tinder. A lightning strike or the encroachment of a ground fire can then ignite a wildfire, with the flame sweeping through both the ground vegetation and upward to the canopies of surrounding savanna forest. A few animals, especially the young, sick, and old, are trapped and killed. The roving prehumans could not have failed to discover the importance of wildfires as a source of food. Moreover, they found some of the felled animals already cooked, with flesh easy to tear off and eat. Australian Aboriginals have not only harvested such bounty up to the present, but also deliberately spread the fires with tree branch torches. Might prehumans have done the same? There is no way to know how the practice first occurred, but it is certain that early in the history of Homo, the control of fire became a pivotal event in the zigzag journey to the modern human condition. The use of fire was, on the other hand, forever denied to insects and other terrestrial invertebrates. They were physically too small to ignite tinder or carry a flaming object without becoming part of the fuel. It was, of course, also denied aquatic animals, regardless of size or prior degree of intelligence of whatever nature. A Homo sapiens level of intelligence can arise only on land, whether here on Earth or on any other conceivable planet. Even in the world of fantasy, mermaids and the god Neptune had to evolve on land before they entered their watery domain. The next step, and the decisive one for the origin of human eusociality, if we accept the evidence from other animals, was the gathering of small groups at campsites. The assemblies were composed of extended families, And also, if surviving modern-day hunter-gatherer societies are a guide, included outsider women obtained by exchange for exogamous marriage. From abundant archaeological evidence, we know that campsites were used by both early African Homo sapiens and its sister European species Homo neanderthalensis, as well as their common ancestor Homo erectus. Hence, the practice dates back at least 1 million years. There is an a priori reason for believing campsites were the crucial adaptation on the path to eusociality. Campsites are, in essence, nests made by human beings. All animal species that have achieved eusociality, without exception, at first built nests that they defended from enemies. They, as did their known antecedents, raised young in the nest, foraged away from it for food, and brought the bounty back to share with others. A variation in the behavior occurs in primitive termites, the ambrosia beetles, and the gall-making aphids and thrips, for which the food is the nest itself. But the basic arrangement, obedient to the biological principle of the primacy of the nest in eusocial evolution, remains the same. Altricial bird species, those that rear helpless young, have a similar pre-adaptation. In a few species, young adults remain with the parents for a while to help care for their siblings, but no bird species has gone on to evolve full-blown eusocial societies. Possessing only a beak and claws, they have never been equipped to handle tools with any degree of sophistication or fire at all. Wolves and African wild dogs hunt in coordinated packs in the same manner as chimpanzees and bonobos, and African wild dogs also dig out dens where one or two females have a large litter. Some pack members hunt and bring a portion of the food to the queen dog and young, while others remain at home as guards. These remarkable canids, although having adopted the rarest and most difficult pre-adaptation, have not reached full eusociality with a worker caste or even ape-level intelligence. They cannot make tools. They lack grasping hands and soft-tipped fingers. They remain four-legged, dependent on their carnassial teeth and fur-sheathed claws. Chapter 4. The Arrival. 2 million years ago, hominid primates strode upon elongated hind legs across African soil. If we apply the criterion of genetic diversity, measured by hereditary differences in anatomy, they were a success. They had achieved an adaptive radiation, in which multiple species coexisted in time and overlapped at least partially in their respective geographical ranges. Two or three were australopithecines, and at least three were different enough in brain size and dentition.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.